Progressive rock has not been reviewed on my channel as much, despite my love for that genre. Why not take the time to review my personal favorite prog band? Van der Graaf Generator is not as well known as Yes or Genesis or even King Crimson, but they're just as good as those bands, if not even better. In fact, Van der Graaf Generator are one of the best bands from England and are arguably even one of the best bands of all time. Their discography is unique, groundbreaking, varied, and despite some low points, contains some of the best prog albums ever. Furthermore, they occupy a very distinct niche. They are most similar to King Crimson, and it is that fanbase which I most recommend Van der Graaf Generator, but the two are still quite different. In short, Van der Graaf Generator are very jazzy and use saxophones instead of guitars, and they are also very dark and atmospheric, even terrifying at times. If you listen to them on acid, you'll have a bad trip. Like the other big prog bands, their talent pool is also remarkable, but most recognizable is the genius vocals and lyrics of Peter Hamill. Let's explore their history and, of course, their incredible music. Van der Graaf Generator was formed in Manchester in 1967 by Peter Hamill and a guy literally named Judge Smith. By 1968, they got one of the most elegant and atmospheric keyboardists of the era, Hugh Banton, on keys, an awesome jazz drummer named Guy Evans, who replaced Judge Smith, some bloke named Keith Ellis on bass, and Peter sang and occasionally played guitar. In 1969, Van der Graaf Generator released their debut, the Aerosol Gray Machine. This album is not like what would come after it, and I don't recommend starting here. There's no jazz, but rather this is psychedelic rock. It's very pastoral and sedate and even quite relaxing, so I do recommend it as a chill-out type album. It does have Peter's vocals, which is never a bad thing, but his uniqueness would come later. Instead, he sings like an angel. Guy's drumming is pretty good, but a bit restrained, and Keith's bass does its job. The star of this album is actually Hugh, who even at the beginning was great. This is a very atmospheric album, and that largely comes from the methodical and ambient keyboards. The main problem, though, is the length. 47 minutes is too long, especially for this album. Overall, this isn't a great album, and is one of the weakest that Van der Graaf Generator would do, but it's a very decent and quite soothing album in its own right. I like it, but it's a bit dated, sloppy, and really only good as evening music. 6 out of 10. Keith was ditched in favor of Nick Potter, and the group, perhaps re-energized, went for a second album. However, there was another new addition. David Jackson, one of the greatest saxophonists alive. In early 1970, they released "The Least We Can Do Is Wave to Each Other." This is the birth of the Van der Graaf Generator that people know and love. This is the album where they really became a prog band, but also developed their signature sound. It's atmospheric, dark, jazzy, catchy even, sometimes pastoral, and of course contains the signature woodwinds of David Jackson and unorthodox vocals of Peter Hamill. every member of the band is important to this. David, of course, provides a lot of the atmosphere and emotion, as does Hugh, while the groove and catchiness would not be there without Guy's jazz-inspired drumming and Nick Potter's groovy bass playing. And, of course, Peter got a bit more unhinged vocally, with more energy, charisma, and craziness. His emotional, skilled, and unorthodox singing is unmistakable, and his ability to terrify, depress, and soothe is incredible. He's easily one of my favorite vocalists, and his uniqueness and prowess really begins here. As for the songs, Darkness 1111, White Hammer, and After the Flood are the epics of the album and are brooding, intense, atmospheric, and highly versatile, and they show a glimpse of the genius that this band would expand upon. The other three songs, however, are harder to praise. Refugees is a ballad that goes on for too long and is a bit annoying, and Out of My Book is quaint and pastoral but unexciting. Whatever Would Have Robert Said is certainly progressive rock, but it lacks catchiness and is just sort of there. Overall, this is a very important and very good album that has inconsistencies. If you consider the track lengths and that the weaker songs aren't outright bad, this is still a great album that I find easy to return to. 8 out of 10. Nick Potter would be out of the band before the end of the year, and in fact he left during the recording of the next album. Hugh Banton would pull a Geddy Lee and do bass and keyboards, and later in 1970, the band's first masterpiece was released. H to he who am the only one.
So you live in the bottom of the sea, and you kill all that come near you.
But H to he is a giant step forward. It's heavier, catchier, darker, more complex, longer, more consistent, and weirder. In fact, this is easily one of my favorite albums of all time, and I even wrote an essay once exploring its lyrics. Long story short, isolation is a recurring theme on this album. Anyways, there are 5 songs here, and they are all God tier. Killer is Vandergraaf Generator's main fan favorite. It's very jazzy, but it's composed like a metal song. Peter's vocals are genuinely mind-blowing, and its admittedly goofy lyrics are very iconic. The sax riffs are as good as any Sabbath riff, and the soloing is up there with the best jazz. Overall, it's a very fun and beautiful song, and one of the best prog songs of all time. House with No Door is a gorgeous and harrowing piano ballad that reveals the album's excellent atmosphere that conveys the feeling of isolation, and in this case, depression. Emperor in His War Room is my personal favorite on the album. It's extremely heavy and atmospheric, with an interplay between smooth, somewhat Asiatic textures and outright metal. By the way, the song has guitars from Robert fucking Fripp on it. I'm not kidding when I say it's very heavy. The lyrics are also remarkably dark and beautiful, and the vocals are vicious. The descent into the dark recesses of existence continues with the 11-minute epic Lost, a song about a breakup, actually. It's not a sappy ballad, though. If you want prog, you'll get it. This particular song is quite possibly the absolute peak of Peter's vocals, with so much intensity and sadness in his voice. Makes you wonder who heard him. The many different solos, breakdowns, riffs, and more atmospheric sections are all very wonderful and dark without sacrificing fun, but let's be real, it's when Peter sings his heart out where this song is most magical. The album ends with a 13-minute epic about being lost in space, I think. Pioneers Over Sea is the most advanced, trippiest, confusing, and beautiful song on the album, both an epic conclusion and a cool down of sorts, if that makes sense. It has plenty of catchiness to keep less patient listeners engaged, but mostly it's a highly expressive, slow burn. And that is H to He Who Am the Only One. What can I say? It's a masterpiece. All 5 songs are brilliant and perfect and God-tier and all that stuff, and thus, so is the album. 10 out of 10. After this album, Van der Graaf Generator's classic lineup of Peter, Hugh, David, and Guy was stabilized. The touring following this album, which they had gotten big enough to do, was rather grueling and in fact a bonding experience. In 1971, they came out with their fourth album, Pawn Hearts.
I don't want to be one way in the world, but sea will drag me deep. One more haggard drown me!
As it turns out, Black Sabbath is not the only band that can release two masterpieces in the span of a year. Instead of capitalizing on their newfound success, Van der Graaf Generator instead went off the deep end, making their darkest, craziest, and most progressive album in their discography. There's only three songs on here, and one of them is 23 minutes, so it's one of those albums. Overall, it isn't too different from its predecessor, but it's less sedate and more energetic and weird. Lemmings is a very chaotic and confusing song with plenty of epic sax riffage and zany breakdowns and solos. It hits you like an isekai truck from the beginning and does not let up, and overall offers a disorientating yet fun experience. Man Erg is the shortest of the three, a very brief 10 minutes, but is also the most accessible. It starts as a depressed piano ballad, but 3 minutes in reveals its true nature, a very chaotic and aggressive song about being possessed or something. It's very scary and intense and genuinely sounds like an anxiety attack, even in its softer moments. Going into the second half of the album, we have the most impressive, daunting, and darkest Van der Graaf Generator song, A Plague of Lighthouse Keepers. It tells the tale of a lighthouse keeper who goes insane from witnessing accidental deaths, and is a very somber and harrowing track, to put it lightly. It's split into 10 movements that vary from more melodic fare to ambient to extremely chaotic and heavy stuff. It's experimental, surprising, catchy, beautiful, dark, and a bunch of different adjectives. It's easily one of the greatest prog songs of all time, and there isn't much more I can say without spoilers. Anyways, this is a very dark and chaotic, yet cohesive and beautiful album, and there is no doubt in my mind that it is perfection. 10 out of 10. After this, the band overexerted themselves. They did several tours, including 3 separate tours in Italy alone, and took too long to make an album. This resulted in running out of funds and not getting any help from their label, so they split up. The members other than Peter, and including Nick Potter, formed a band that actually doesn't have a name, and released a Van der Graaf Generator-esque album called The Long Hello, while Peter started a solo project, both of which I will possibly review in the future. By 1975, Van der Graaf Generator was ready to unite, and they released their comeback album, God Bluff.
Stop towers in the distance, riders cross the blasted moor. Against the horizon,
this is the album that got me into this band, and I recommend starting here. It's shorter and more accessible, but just as dark and beautiful. In a way, this is the Van der Graaf Generator album, and ultimately their greatest work. Why? Because despite its sacrifices, it ultimately has the best songs. The Undercover Man is a very deceptive ballad. It's very soft and atmospheric and even a bit pastoral, but it describes a mental breakdown. It's very dark and haunting, especially as it grows in intensity. Scorched Earth is a very fiery and bombastic epic, and easily the most fun Van der Graaf Generator song. It describes the destruction left by warfare, while its heaviness and jazz elements result in a visceral atmosphere. It's just a blast. Arrow is a bit gloomier. Its jazz intro gives way to a bleak, mid-paced epic that sounds disorientating and depressed. It's my least favorite of the four, but it's still basically perfection. Finally, The Sleepwalkers, an 11-minute epic, concludes the album, with methodical but chaotic instrumentation, maniacal vocals, and the most bombastic and awesome climax in any Van der Graaf Generator song. What does this amount to? A dark, chaotic, beautiful, and catchy masterpiece that is easier to get into than the albums before and after it, but ultimately shows Van der Graaf Generator at the height of their powers. God Bluff is one of the best albums of the 70s, one of the best prog albums ever, hell, maybe even one of the greatest albums ever, and is Van der Graaf Generator's magnum opus. 10 out of 10. Only half a year later, there was a follow-up. In 1976, Still Life was released.
The streets seem very crowded. I put on my bravest guise. I know you know that I am acting. I can see it in your eyes.
Still Life is a very hard album. It emanates with intelligence and lacks the jazzy intensity of the previous albums in favor of a more restrained, atmospheric, and symphonic approach. Between its subtle complexity and decrease in catchiness, it's a grower, and a very challenging grower at that. However you frame it, this album just isn't as good. Pilgrims feels like an inferior retread of The Undercover Man, but with more bombast. It's certainly memorable and entertaining, but it leaves a little to be desired. Still Life is even softer and more ominous, exploring the pros and cons of immortality, and that's where the album's brilliance comes out. It's very haunting and thought-provoking. La Rosa is a bit heavier and more energetic and remains my favorite song on the album. It's less thematically interesting, but hey, it kicks ass. My Room Waiting for Wonderland is much jazzier, but it returns to the softness that Still Life is defined by. It's a brilliant track, I suppose, but the lack of catchiness is really starting to be felt. The album ends with Childlike Faith and Childhood's End, a 13-minute epic that picks up the pace and sounds more familiar, but overall doesn't have the catchiness that defines the other big epics, so it ends up losing my attention. Overall, I appreciate the passion and creativity that went into this album, but the slow pace means that I have no choice but to regulate it to evening music, and the lack of catchiness means that it just isn't as fun or memorable. I suppose another way of looking at it is that it's dense and pensive, so it's hard to chill out to, but it's not very exciting. Still Life is a good album, but it's extremely frustrating and limited in its appeal. 7 out of 10. Perhaps they were so afraid of idling too long that they idled too little. 6 months later, and only a year after the release of God Bluff, was the release of World Record. World Record is the exact opposite of Still Life. Rather than being pensive, it's groovy, energetic, catchy, and fun. I like relaxing and softer music, but when it comes to this particular band, I generally prefer the more intense and catchy stuff. World Record satisfies that itch. When She Comes is extremely catchy and amorous, and how it isn't more of a fan favorite is beyond me. A Place to Survive is more drawn out and groovy, with exquisite sax riffs and enough versatility to not get old. Masks is the album's weak spot. It's not bad or anything, it just fails to be memorable, I guess. It's a filler. Then, for the second and last time, Van der Graaf Generator would go for a 20-minute epic. Merglis 3 is, in fact, my favorite Van der Graaf Generator song. the storytelling contained in its lyrics, the passionate and expressive vocals, the excellent riffs and breakdowns, the feeling in all of the instrumentation, and yes, even the reggae section towards the end. It's all amazing. The bleak story of introversion, the intense solos, and the versatility and progression all add up to a dynamic, surprising, entertaining, and heartbreaking song. This is one of the finest epics any prog band has ever created. That is not the end of the album, as you might anticipate. The conclusion is Wondering, a bombastic and pretty song that is quite good, but ultimately very out of place and largely devoid of catchiness. Overall, World Record is not the most loved Van der Graaf Generator album, but I quite like it. It's held back by its two shortest songs, but otherwise it's a charming and imaginative album and a great conclusion to Van der Graaf Generator's classic lineup. 8 out of 10. Oh yeah, they would implode after this. Overworked and stressed after a disastrous tour in Italy, Hugh Banton left the band, and so did David Jackson. Hugh was replaced with Nick Potter, returning on bass duties, and a guy named Graham Smith on violin. Would this reinvigorate them, or would they shit the bed? Or would they get something else entirely? In 1977, they shortened their name to Van der Graaf and released The Quiet Zone, The Pleasure Dome.
I remember what it felt like at 17. I was a cat, a snake, a lizard, a mouse. Still got an interest in the limousine and her spouse. And all that.
Progressive rock in the late 70s had a bit of an apocalypse. The genre lost most of its commercial potential, and its musicians were creatively worn out, so all of its bands either broke up or switched genres. Although it would only be for a single album, Van der Graaf Generator switched to post-punk, except a very strange take on post-punk that sounds very pastoral, yet glamorous. Other than a certain album which I'll get to later, this is the most different and unusual of Van der Graaf Generator's albums, and remains a very unique album in general. The acoustic guitars and violins evoke simple and rural living, while the more chaotic moments, lyrics and vocals, and the general atmosphere sound much more fast-paced and urban. The juxtaposition of rural and urban moods results in a highly disorientating album that evokes feelings of postmodern confusion and self-discovery. If that doesn't make any sense, well, I told you this is a strange album. To frame this album more practically, it's great for driving at night, and is also less progressive and more oriented around shorter, catchier songs. Speaking of which, this album also has a great amount of variety. Lizard Play and The Habit of the Broken Heart are more direct and punkish, while The Siren Song and The Wave are softer and more precarious. Last Frame is the closest thing to prog on here, sampling the rest of the album's different approaches. Cat's Eye Yellow Fever and The Sphinx in the Face are my two favorite songs on here, and encapsulate the catchiness, bombast, contrasting moods, and manic energy that this album offers, and also act as the album's climax. The closer, Chemical World, is pensive and anxious. Although not as bombastic, it does leave a memorable and haunting final impression. And lastly, The Sphinx Returns is an amusing and sweet outro to finish Van der Graaf Generator's final album for nearly 3 decades. My final thoughts? Opinions are very mixed on this album. It's unusual in every way, but damn if it isn't excellent. It's catchy and fun, yet deeply artistic and moody. How could I not love it? The Quiet Zone, The Pleasure Dome gets a 9 out of 10. The touring that followed that album contained a much more aggressive style of performing, and included a number of Peter's solo songs. Van der Graaf Generator just weren't themselves anymore. So, in 1978, they broke up. In 1979, Keith Ellis, their original bass player, died. Peter focused on his solo work and released many solo albums, which sometimes featured Hugh, David, and Guy. Speaking of which, in their downtime, Hugh designed and worked on organs, David worked in music therapy and some other bands, and Guy was a full-time musician. And that's how it was for 2.5 decades. After several reunion shows, Van der Graaf Generator reformed in 2005 and made their second comeback album, Present. Present is a double album, but the two discs fundamentally have nothing to do with each other, and basically this is just two albums, and I shall review them as such. The first album is a more conventional one, and the second is instrumental and improvised. They each have their own beginning and end, and offer different experiences. Ideally, they are listened to back-to-back, and of course they have some major similarities, but otherwise are their own entities. This is unlike, say, The Wall, which is one album that's split in two due to its sheer length. Anyways, let's talk about disc one. It's quite excellent, but not very surprising, which is fine since this is a comeback. It's actually quite fanservice-y, and is a throwback to God Bluff and the two albums before it. Hugh does the atmosphere, Guy does the awesome jazz drums, David does the eloquent sax playing, and Peter, well, that's what's different.
As one by one our voices falter, lords and masters determined to cast us in the roles of serfs and slaves in the new empire's name.
He's less youthful and manic and sounds like an old man now. His vocals are still beautiful and impassioned, but instead are much more restrained and pensive. Both his earlier and later vocals are great in their own way. The songs themselves are all very good and offer all the things I want from this band. Every Bloody Emperor and Nutter Alert are the main highlights, however. Also, the production is modern and polished, but still very atmospheric. It makes the album very heavy, but lets things get quiet when needed. Anyways, this is a fantastic assortment of songs that, although maybe not as iconic or fun, are extremely solid. 8 out of 10. As for the second disc, it's 10 improvised tracks. It has the same atmosphere as the first disc, but is much jazzier and is without vocals. It's the weaker of the two since it doesn't have those memorable riffs or catchiness. But for what it is, it's great. I quite enjoy Van der Graaf Generator's jazzier side, and it's great to hear them let loose and vibe in a studio setting. It's fantastic as background or evening music in particular. I'm going with a strong 7 out of 10. Overall, Present, with its two albums within itself, is a fantastic comeback, and foreshadows what we shall see is the best late career of any vintage prog band. I do think the two discs should have been released separately, but oh well. This reunion of the classic lineup sadly did not last. David Jackson had a falling out with the rest of the band and left after it became apparent that his presence, pun intended, wouldn't work. The remaining members decided to continue as a saxless trio instead. In 2008, they pulled a Genesis and named their next album after the size of their band. Trisector. Without any woodwinds, one of the main components of Van der Graaf Generator's sound was missing, and fundamental change was needed. Previously, Hugh Banton had mostly provided atmosphere, and the hooks and stuff largely came from David and Peter. With this dynamic no longer possible, Trisector gives way to a highly symphonic version of the band, where Hugh absolutely shines. His lush and layered keys create a beautiful and warm album. His dominance is furthered by Guy and Peter being a bit more restrained and subtle, which I don't mind. Meanwhile, rather than the frenetic approach that Present took, Trisector is also more on the pensive side. I think fans of Still Life will quite like this one. That does mean Trisector also suffers from Still Life's main problem. In its pensiveness and relaxation, it can be a bit sleepy, limiting its appeal. However, where Still Life requires lots of concentration to appreciate, you can turn off your brain and chill out to Trisector. Only in a Whisper is definitely my favorite song on here, although most of the tracks have something remarkable about them. Overall, this is a wonderful album with lots of atmosphere and beauty. The composition is excellent and the lush arrangements are fantastic. Van der Graaf Generator prove that they can still be great when stripped down. That said, I can't help but feel that this is mood music, so to speak. 8 out of 10. In between albums, Van der Graaf Generator toured the US for like the second time in their career, which is nice, and in 2011, they released another album, A Grounding in Numbers.
He scattered himself all over the place while
This is one of the most underrated and misunderstood albums by this band. It often is ignored or forgotten, but is in fact full of brilliance. This is because it is absolutely a grower. It needs multiple listens, but if you can afford it your patience, you shall be rewarded. This album is very different from Trisector. It ditches the lush symphonic approach in favor of a very angular and jagged sound that also brings back elements of post-punk and also uses guitars much more. The songs are sharp and oafish and also short. There's 13 tracks and they range from 2 to 6 minutes. However, unlike the long burn that is Trisector, this is varied and intense, with confusing and disorientating songs that remind me of my own autism. The range of sounds explored ranges from callbacks to classic Van der Graaf Generator to pure post-punk, and both aspects of this album are done excellently. Also, this album is very catchy. It takes a couple listens for the catchiness to click, but it's there. Another observation is that it kind of feels like one big epic. Despite the songs being more bite-sized, they all flow together and in a good way. Previously, this had been one of my least favorite Van der Graaf Generator albums, but I now realize that it is a masterpiece. It's consistent, catchy, varied, atmospheric, emotional, and expressive. It doesn't quite soar to the heights of some of the albums from the 70s, but this affirmed Van der Graaf Generator's standing as the vintage prog band with the best late career. A Grounding in Numbers is weird and anxious, and I love it. 9 out of 10. While on the road, Van der Graaf Generator got in an experimental mood and recorded their next album in their free time. In 2012, Alt was released. This is the weakest Van der Graaf Generator album by far. However, I don't think it is meant to stand alongside the other albums. It is less of a main album and more of a side project, and it's only a main album in the sense that it's studio recordings of new material. Basically, this is freely improvised, minimalist, ambient music. Peter and Hugh toyed around with their instruments and made an hour of bollocks. What about Guy, you might be wondering? Well, in addition to being an ambient album, it's also free jazz because the melodic side of the album is juxtaposed with improvised jazz drumming. It's a juxtaposition that doesn't work. Want proof that Guy Evans is an amazing drummer? Look no further. Want proof that minimalist ambient and jazz drumming don't go together? Again, look no further. As a fan of ambient music, I can tell you that this is certainly quite avant-garde, but also utter crap. It's not relaxing, but it's not very engaging either. It's quite obnoxious and actually rather bad. You got out-of-place percussion and annoying effects that cause a headache more than they cause any kind of enjoyment, and there's an hour of it. I recommend skimming this album if you are curious, but I do not recommend this album if you want a good time. I'll give it credit for being extremely interesting and having virtuoso drumming, but even then, those are debatably virtuous. 3 out of 10. 4 years later, Van der Graaf Generator came back for seemingly their final album. They are getting old, and sooner or later it would be time for the grand finale to their discography. We would indeed get that with 2016's Do Not Disturb. Do Not Disturb is the best of Van der Graaf Generator's later albums, and remains one of their finest works. It is a culmination of all their prior achievements, and the album their career has been leading up to. It combines the riffs of A Grounding in Numbers, the gorgeous synth melodies of Trisector, the mania of The Quiet Zone, the catchiness of World Record, the bleak pensiveness of Still Life, and the darkness and complexity of H. Tahi through God Bluff. Not all at the same time, of course. There's plenty of variety here. Aloft is intense and riffy. Alpha Berlina is slow and symphonic. Go even brings an ambience, and so on. All that's missing is psych rock, and I don't take issue with its exclusion. However, there is a new element, and one that unites all of the songs on this album. These are old men, full of stories and wisdom. It's a slow, contemplative, and deeply mature album. It has flurries of emotion and moments of quiet reflection. It's slow-paced but easygoing and sparse. It's a very welcoming and approachable album, with very distinct and easy-to-get-into songs, but at the same time has enough depth that you can get more out of it with each listen. Thematics aside, all of the songs are great and offer plenty of prog goodness, but if you want your music to be meaningful, it's a very beautiful and complex album. If you want highlights, there are four in particular. Aloft opens the album with plenty of energy and atmosphere. It's got impassioned vocals, quaint keys, and catchy riffs. Oh No, I Must Have Said Yes is all riffs, which for this band is exceptional, but it's very fun and catchy. The best song in here is one of the band's very best, Almost the Words. It begins as a somber ballad, one that nearly summons tears, and becomes intense in its second half, working as the album's climax. Although not as dark or intense as the band's early work, the level of musical beauty here is unmatched. The album ends with Go, an ambient song that is best described as a graceful and haunting exit. Overall, Do Not Disturb is incredible. It's a testament to just how well these guys have been able to retain their creativity over the decades and produce, well, a masterpiece this late in the game. It is varied, consistent, fun at times, but mostly beautiful and deeply affecting. Do Not Disturb gets a 10 out of 10. In conclusion, Van der Graaf Generator are one of the greatest prog bands of all time, without a doubt. Their innovation, virtuoso musicianship, masterful lyrics, songwriting ability, range of emotions and sounds, and if nothing else, the sheer quality of their discography is almost too good to be true. If it weren't for Aerosol and Alt, they would have a perfect discography. All of their albums are different, and almost all of them are great in their own way. And of course, I can't deny just how impressive their late career is. At that stage, they should have fallen off, but they didn't. How does that even occur? Unfortunately, they spent most of their history inactive, although that's made up for by their excellent careers outside of the band. The real tragedy is how little known they are. Yeah, sure, I'm a fanboy, but when the music is this good, it's hard not to be a fanboy. I've said all my imagination allows me to say, and so I shall wrap up this video. Thank you for making it to the end. This was a long haul, but I think this is the best video I've ever made. My ranking is on screen now. Incidentally, the prospect of making a gigantic Van der Graaf generator review is what encouraged me to start making these videos, and contributed to my return to YouTube. Thus, my band reviews have been leading up to this, in a way. Therefore, I shall thank all of you who have been watching my band reviews, as well as voting for them and commenting on them. Y'all are great. Anyways, this video has gone on long enough. I shall see you soon.